Hi and welcome to Rosedale Park in Albany for Game 4 of the New Zealand Community Trust Softball Series between New Zealand and Japan. Well, the world champion Barotcard Black Sox have a 2-0 lead in the series as we head into Game 3, winning the first game in Nelson by 9-1 and the second game in Lower Hutt by 10-2. And Mark Sorensen, those scores will have surprised a few people.
I think they really did. I was expecting that the games would be a lot closer, but the power and explosive batting that New Zealand has really come to the fore, and we've seen a lot of runs coming by the home run.
So the Barotcard Black Sox getting off to that great start in Nelson, winning by 9-1. Let's have a look at some of the highlights of that game.
A big crowd turned out to witness the first ever softball test to be held in Nelson. Ueno opened the scoring for Japan with a home run in the first inning, which was also to take outfielder Stacey McLean out of the series with a broken arm. In the bottom of the second innings, Thomas Makia found a gap in the outfield. And Brad Rona came up with the hit to bat him in and tie the game up. A two-run automatic by Fabian Makia in the bottom of the third. And not to be outdone, a grand slam home run by his brother Thomas in the fourth put the result beyond doubt. But the Black Sox weren't finished yet. On the very next pitch, Donnie Hale put the icing on the cake when he also cleared the fence for a 9-1 win.
So convincing wins for New Zealand in the first two games. But Jeremy, if you look at the statistics, Japan have actually been very competitive.
Yes, they have been. The scorelines wouldn't necessarily reflect that, with New Zealand having amassed 19 runs to Japan's 3. But if we take Game 2, for instance, the Japanese collected 6 hits to the Black Sox 8, just a difference of 2. There's two reasons, though, why the Black Sox have been so dominant on the scoreboard. The first, as Mark mentioned, has been the fact that New Zealand have scored 6 automatic home runs to Japan's 2. Also the fact that in Game 2, Japan had 8 opportunities to collect hits with runners on base. They were only able to get 1 hit with runners on base, and that is the statistic that will need to improve if they want to be competitive in this series. So welcome to Rosedale Park in Albany as we see the Barotcard Black Sox just completing their haka. A little bit of light rain falling here at Rosedale Park, but nothing that's going to be a problem for play so far. Let's have a look at the lineups for these two teams. First of all, let's see the home team, New Zealand, and doing the pitching in this game will be Michael Gager from Auckland. Mark, no surprise?
No, I don't believe it is. I think that we've seen Marty Grant on the mound for the first game of the series. Paul Elgar pitched the second game in Wellington, and through the course of going through a rotation, I believe it looks like Don Tricker is now going to go with Michael Gager in this game. Plus, plays his local ball up in the Auckland region, so sort of all comes together and points towards him being the man on the mound today.
And the team for Japan for Game 3 of this New Zealand Community Trust Trophy Series. Doing the pitching will be Augie. He came in during the game in Nelson, Jeremy.
Yes, well, he's the one pitcher for this Japanese side for whom the verdict is still out, if you like. New Zealand have punished the other 4 pitchers that we've seen so far for Japan, but Augie, he came in towards the end of the first test. He pitched just 2 innings but conceded no hits. So he's the one pitcher, if you like, who's had a little bit of success against this Black Sox side. And this is important. This is the last throw of the dice, if you like, for Japan. They need to win this game to stay in the series.
So it'll be Japan batting at the top of the first innings. We'll run through the New Zealand defensive lineup for you. So Gager doing the pitching to Patrick Shannon. At first base will be the New Zealand captain, Jared Martin. At second base, Rhys Casely. Playing at third base is Brad Rona. Shortstop today, Roman Gabriel. In left field will be Donnie Hale. Centre field will be Thomas Makia. And in right field, his younger brother, Fabian Makia. Fabian Makia, certainly one of the standout players for New Zealand so far in the series, a home run in the first two games.
Yeah, he's really been hitting the ball well. You know, he's a very strong player, hits the ball well to the left field region. Both his home runs have come over the centre left field area. And he's proved a really tough out. It certainly hasn't been struck out, I don't believe, in the series to date. Made good solid contact and proved to be a thorn in the side of the Japanese.
So here is Michael Gager. You can see the rain falling here at Rosedale Ballpark. We had a bit of rain in game two of the series as well, and it did cause a few problems to the pitchers, didn't it?
Yeah, I managed to get a chance to speak to Nishimura, who pitched the game in Lower Hutt. And I saw him at the airport, and he was saying that he really struggled with the ball once it got wet. They're not used to using a wet ball, but also the synthetic surface that we have, with the moisture, the rain that was there last night, contributed to making it rather a greasy ball to grip, and I think that certainly reflected in the way that New Zealand just started pounding him.
Well, we had some wild pitches and a couple of walks from Nishimura, quite uncharacteristic for him. Of course, he has been probably the leading pitcher in Japan over the last 10 years. And I think he really was expected to be their best chance here in this series. We will see him again because this is only game three, but today it'll be Ogie who will have the chance starting for Japan. The leadoff batter there in the back of your picture. That's Hiroyuki Nasaoka.
Yes, the statistics there for Sasaoka, one hit from six at-bats. Not the sort of hitting average we'd necessarily want to see from a leadoff hitter.
Here we go, you're losing the best teams
so
in the world.
Number 25, Sasaoka, the designated player today, batting for the pitcher, Ogie, and facing the pitching of number 17 there in the red shirt, Michael Gager, from the Hutt Valley, but now plays for the Ramblers Club in Auckland. And the plate umpire there, Lindsay Edwards.
We see Sasaoka here has played against Michael in Japan a number of times for his token centre side, while Michael had his, I think he was over there for 3 or 4 years, playing in the Japanese private league there.
One ball, one strike on the Japanese league. Well, Michael Gager has probably, of all the New Zealand team, the best knowledge of the Japanese scene, having spent 7 seasons. In the New Zealand winter, playing in Japan. Strike two on Sasaoka.
I suppose the flip side of that is that he'd be the one pitcher that the Japanese would be the most familiar with out of this New Zealand pitching staff as well.
Shot there just earlier of Rhys Casely, his second game for New Zealand.
He's an office quick.
The only debutant in this Barotrauma Black Sox team. Did make an appearance in the game in Nelson. Started in Lower Hutt in game two. And now starting at second base here in game three. In fact, he played in the outfield in game two. So really, the Black Sox coach is there exploiting his versatility.
Yeah, I think that's the key. And certainly an area that Rhys brings some power and add some value to the ballpark is that he is able to play a number of different positions.
In the dirt this time from Gager.
And I think the two key positions that he really specialises at, second base and in the outfield, able to really show his versatility and athleticism there.
So full count now on the leadoff for Japan, Sasaoka. Hit this one straight down to Jared Hunt at third base, who does the fielding himself. That's the first out on the top of the first innings.
Jared Hunt, the boy Jared.
Here we see Sasaoka just turning on an inside rise ball that Michael left out over the plate a little bit more than what he would have liked. Comfortably taken by Jared, unassisted at first base.
Jared Martin now captaining the Black Sox team. And the next batter in is Sunishi Nagayoshi, second baseman. Contact with this one again, it's down to Martin. Race to the base, and in fact, he's called safe. So Martin took a bit of a punt there, decided to do the fielding himself because Casely was coming in to receive the ball, but Nagayoshi beats Martin to the base and Japan have a base runner.
This is a benefit of left-handed hitting. Your high hopper in the infield and Jared could have probably popped it up to Rhys Casey at first and we see a bang-bang play that our umpire decides the tie is going to go to the runner on this occasion.
So that'll bring in Ueno, Masashi Ueno. Now, this is one of the big hitters in the Japanese team. He hit home runs in game one and game two. In fact, here at Rosedale Park during the D-Shick tournament, he hit a three-run homer in a tie break for Japan. So he's shown us that he is a very capable hitter on this tour. And now comes up to bat with the runner on base. Ooh, this one, Ueno has to duck to get out of the way.
Here's just a reminder from Gager as to who's in charge there. Ueno, two hits from six at bats. So both his hits were those two automatics. Yeah, and not much else.
Yeah, a little bit of chin music there, I think. Just a message sent through there. His two hits that he had does have home runs.
The runner was on the way with the steal. Here's the throw. And the out has made it second base. So nice throw from the New Zealand catcher. Has the Japanese base runner taken out at two.
Great job behind the plate here by Patrick Shannon. See, he gets up in position nice and quick and just throws a strike down to Reese Casey at second, who's able to take the out.
Seems a little bit of a strange decision with probably your best hitter of the series so far up to bat. One down, stealing the runner. Japan attacking the game.
Possibly what their coach Ngawa's thinking about is that maybe with the two hidings that they've had previously in the series, if they're going to have an opportunity to beat New Zealand, they've really got to take the game to them, because they've had leads in both of the earlier games and they relinquished them as the game wore on. So maybe the opportunity now is to go hard right from the start.
So it's the first strike there against Ueno then, three balls and one strike. Ueno just asking for clarification of the count. Jared Martin, Black Sox captain, at first base.
Yes, just a bit of a breakdown there between him and Reese Casey. It was probably better just to let Reese take the ball, as Reese was heading into first base on that play at one. Either that or do what Mark suggested, which was just toss the ball up to Reese Casey covering first base, because the ball travels that much quicker than a fielder trying to get back to a base like that.
Yeah, I think even in that situation there, yeah, Reese is probably just a little bit nervous here for the first time he's played in the infield. Only his second game for the Black Sox, so it's sort of new territory for him. He's just trying to feel as well, I'm sure.
Pitch inside, and this one will land safely in the infield. The play is made, though, by Roman Gabriel.
Nice out by Roman Gabriel to retire the side.
I think Michael Gage has really showed his intentions here as he jams Ueno on a pitch, and he's unable to catch the little soft liner back, but the ever-present Roman Gabriel is there to gobble it up and retire Japan here in the first innings.
Black Sox coach Don Tricker, he'll be pretty happy with the way his team have played so far in the series. And in fact, after a game two in Lower Hutt, he really paid tribute to his batters. He said, you know, you have to remember that while Japan is ranked second in the world, New Zealand has among them the best batters in the world. And if a pitcher throws a bad pitch, they're going to punch it.
By the club room, the souvenirs have been sold.
Certainly have been impressive, the Black Sox batters.
And there's FPOS available over there, and there's merchandise, soft
ball
merchandise.
We'll see them come out to bat for the first time in this game here at the bottom of the first.
When you get time.
Japan with a runner on base in the first innings, but unable to capitalise. A good crowd here at Rosedale Park. I guess probably just over 1,000 people. As the rain starts to come down again. I think we saw in the game two in Lower Hutt, Mark, that the officials will persist if it's raining. It'll have to be quite bad for them to stop.
Well, I agree. You know, they're not going to call the game or postpone the game at this stage just for a little shower going on here. There's a good crowd here. The local association's put a lot of work into promoting and preparing for the series, and obviously we've brought an international team that have come a long way to play, so they'll be trying to make every endeavour to get the game through.
So it'll be Clayton Willocks leading off for New Zealand in the bottom of the first, as he has done earlier in the series. Designated player today. He's in the field. He'd be playing either at second base or at third base. But today he'll just bat. He'll be followed by Reese Casely. Then it'll be Jared Martin. This is where you start getting the meat of the New Zealand order. Those big hitters, Jared Martin, Thomas Markier, Donny Hale, Patrick Shannon, all with home runs so far in this series. Awesome batting lineup for any pitching staff to take on. And Willett's now playing at his home ground, of course, because he has shifted to North Harbour, plays for the Northcote team.
Peyton Willett's two hits from four turns at bat. Those first two hits coming in that first test in Nelson, a safe bunt and a safe hit to left field, but then went a little bit quiet in the Hutt Valley. Two strikeouts before he was replaced in the lineup for New Zealand.
Now let's see what he can do in game three. Ball one from Augie. We saw Augie for a couple of innings in Nelson. Mark, what were your thoughts on him?
I thought he did exceptionally well. Like, came on, there was a marked difference in pace between himself and Baba that had got pounded around the park. He's been widely renowned as being the number two pitcher in Japan, as Clayton Woolock's just hit the line drive right back to him.
Takes the first out.
Fielded by the pitcher for the first out of the game.
As a leadoff hitter, you're really looking to make good contact this first innings to start the game off. And there you see Ogie was barely through his follow-through, and the ball was back in his glove as Woolock's had really drilled the ball hard.
So Reese Casey now comes in to fill this number two spot. In the first game of the series in Nelson, it was Stacey McLean from Wellington who was batting at number two, but because of an injury, he's now out of the series. Oh, and Casey takes one on the hip, and he'll take a base for that.
I'm sure it's not going to hurt him that much. It's his first time on base playing for the Black Sox, so he'll be loving it.
Probably not the way he wanted to get there.
And on deck, number 21.
He's just laying a smoke screen there on that pitch. He's going to look to steal in these first couple of pitches to second, maybe.
Oh, and people say to him in the years to come, how did you get on base the first time at bat for the Black Sox? So we'll be able to say, see this, Bruce?
Yep.
See this, Mark? So New Zealand have a base runner in the bottom of the first innings. Casey on with a hit pitch. Brings to bat Jared Martin. So we'll talk a little bit about that injury to Stacey McLean later in the game. Ball one.
Jared Martin had an enjoyable test in Hutt Valley. Those statistics were looking a little bit worrisome going into that second test, but he collected two hits from three turns at bat in Lower Hutt, including three runs batted in. So it was a good test for him, and he's just improved those figures somewhat going into test three.
Ball two.
So ball two on Jared Martin. Just see the Japanese catcher jumping out to the side there, Ito. We've seen him do that quite a bit in this series, working the outside of the plate with his pitches. First strike against Martin.
Strike one, ball two.
Eddie Colassi there, standing down at first base, assistant coach of the Black Sox team. Big swing and a miss from Martin. Two balls, two strikes. Martin will be followed by Thomas Markier, you see there with the wall paint. Martin pops this one up, it'll go foul though.
High fly ball by Darren. keeps them in there. Strike two. Ball two.
Yes, Stacey McLean lasted just a few minutes, really, of the series. Down in Nelson in game one, taking a catch in the outfield. Trying to take a catch in the outfield. He was trying to stop a home run, and he tumbled over the fence, fell awkwardly, and broke his arm, broke his forearm. He's since had surgery on that arm and a plate inserted. Low ball this time from Augie. That'll load up the count. Three balls, two strikes. And really a terrible blow for a player like Stacey McLean.
Yeah, certainly is. You know, Stacey's worked really hard on his game, and I think he's really developing into one of our premium outfielders. He's got a great arm out there. He runs the ball down well, and his hitting is just coming on every season. He's becoming a more and more consistent player all round. So certainly a big blow.
Martin hits this one. It's high, but it's not a long way back. Above the shortstop. And the catch is made.
Fourth
second out of the innings. So two down, and the runner remains at first.
Akishi Ogasawa.
They've worked both sides of the plate here to Jared, and finish up with jamming him on an inside rise ball as it's popped up way in the air to shortstop Ogasawara.
Brings into bat Thomas Markia.
Here it comes.
Grand Slam home run for Thomas Markia in the first game of the series in Nelson. He'll be followed by Donnie Hale. Ball one. Mark, might get you to tell us a little bit about the paint that Thomas has under his eyes. I understand that that's now a sticker.
Yeah, it is. Used to be a... come from a tube of toothpaste, and you'd put it on your finger and wipe it underneath, and it just takes the glare away from your eyes. Thomas not comfortable with wearing sunglasses while hitting.
Outside but, of the plate for...
But it's amazing how things have progressed, and now that we're using an elastoplast band-aid is stuck under your eye for the game, and then he's able to peel it off. It's a lot better for the uniforms. Is when guys were playing and sweating so much, you tend to wipe your brow and you'd end up getting this black mascara type substance on uniform, and it was really a nightmare to get out.
Not a good look, is it?
Not a good look. Used to rub my knuckles raw just trying to clean my uniform after each game. Yeah?
I'm glad to hear it was you. So ball three to Thomas Markia. Augie doing his best to pitch around some of these big hitters in the New Zealand team. Runner on first, two down. Ball four to Thomas Markia. He picked the walk, and New Zealand have two runners on now.
Reece Casely on two.
Casely moves down to second. Markia on first. Into bat, Donnie Hale.
Donnie Hale, and on deck, Patrick Shannon.
It doesn't get any easier for the Japanese pitcher, because Hale has a home run already in the series.
They're really paying Thomas Markia the ultimate compliment there. He's probably been, you know, of all of the New Zealand batters, I think he's probably been the hottest with the consistency that we've seen. Certainly got the series off with a bang on down in Nelson in game one of the series.
Ball one to Donnie Hale.
Yes, and this has been the area where the Black Sox have been superior to Japan, and that is collecting hits with runners on base. And these sorts of situations have managed to come up with an automatic home run that has scored, you know, not just the person hitting, but, you know, two or three further runs as well. Phil Augie is really struggling for control in this first inning. He's been behind in the count a number of times.
Hale connects with this one, but sends it foul.
Strike one, ball one.
He's been very definite about every pitch, isn't he? He's taken a while to get the call. He's quite slow.
I think that just reflects how hard it is to pitch to this lineup. There are so many talented hitters in this Black Sox team that he has to be working out what he's doing with every pitch, not only in the context of this batter, but also in the context of the inning and the game, because he's got runners on base. He can't afford to pitch too many good strikes when he's behind in the count. He's almost better to be walking the likes of Thomas Mark here than trying to come back on a three-ball, no-strike count with a pitch that's right there.
I think one deliberate ball, is the word I'm after. It's very deliberate, isn't it? The way he's looking for the call, they're taking their time making, deciding what they're going to do here. Inside for a ball to Donnie Hale.
It's certainly a reflection of the way that the Japanese have evolved over the years with their pitching, is that they are very definite and deliberate with their whole approach to the game, and that they really try and work hard to keep the ball away from the middle of the strike zone. They really try and nibble on the corners and get the hitters swinging at pitches that they want them to swing at rather than the pitches the hitters want to swing at.
Hale swings at the low pitch.
So he's really trying to stretch that strike zone, you know. Part of his role on the mound is to identify where the umpire's strike zone is and then try and stretch it as much as possible. So that drop ball we just saw Donnie Hale swing at started at the bottom of the zone, but it dropped well out. And the discipline we've seen from the Black Sox here tonight, today, to date, has been superior to the precise nature of the pitching from Ogie.
So two balls, two strikes, the count on Donnie Hale. Two runners on. This one again is high, but it hasn't gone very far. It'll come down in the infield. Catch is made, and the third out is taken.
Makes the third out.
So two runners left on base for New Zealand in the bottom of the first innings. And Japan get out of trouble.
Bottom of the first innings, ladies and gentlemen.
Donnie Hale's just popped up on a rise ball that was left over the plate, and Donnie just had a little bit of an uppercut on that swing, and as we see Iguchi come in rather unconvincingly, taking it with one hand, certainly not a great example for some of the young kids that we've got here today, as we're teaching them to catch with two hands. And when he came in late like that, there was a bit of confusion.
Yeah, this is the top of the second innings, New Zealand and Japan playing game three of the New Zealand Community Trust Trophy Series. No score, but both teams had runners on base in the first inning, so that bodes well.
Yes, it does. It bodes well for viewers, certainly. And judging by the games that we've seen so far, it's fairly much running to form of what we've seen. There's been plenty of action. Unfortunately for the Japanese, it's mostly been on the Black Sox side of the score sheet.
Look at that statistic there. Okamoto, certainly one of the power hitters from Japan, hasn't hit yet in six turns at bat.
And still batting at number four in the lineup. So obviously they believe that he will come right. Tomowaki Okamoto playing at first base. Pops this one up into foul territory.
Foul ball.
It's really a hard thing to do. What the Japanese are doing here is to come out of the dead of winter and come right into the middle of our season and compete on a level playing field with us. Now, we've done this a number of times, and I can understand with what Okamoto is going through. You like to, you know, we're players, as players, you've all got egos, you all like to get hits, and if you don't start the tour with a couple of hits, or start a series with a couple of hits, you start pressing, and you start finding reasons to actually get yourself out, as opposed to letting the pitcher get you out. So it really becomes a mind game now.
So a mental battle for Okamoto. One ball, one strike is the count. Popped up again, a chance for the catcher, but no, just clear of netting.
Mark, there's been a fair amount of comment about how tough the itinerary's been for this Japanese side. It's not easy though, is it? Because there's one camp that says they're coming out of season, the more games the better probably, and then there's the other side that are saying they've had too much softball, they're a bit tired.
Yeah, I think there's a very fine line. You know, they certainly need games to prepare themselves, but we've also got to respect the fact that the human body can only take so much. You know, we've had it all done to us when we've been away. And
ball on the dirt, the ball two, strike two.
And it's, you know, we go to Japan, we've played 20 games in 15 days in about six different cities. So I guess, there's a couple of schools of thought. I certainly believe that they've maybe played one or two games too many in between the Deanshik tournament they started off and now this international series, because of the five games, they're playing in four different cities over four different days, so that takes its toll as well.
full count now on Okamoto, 3 balls, 2 strikes. What about the calibre of the opposition they've played as well? Because they've played some pretty tough games, you know, against Nikki Cavuni in the final of the Ding Shik, 7 internationals in that team. Against the New Zealand Māori team, 8 internationals, and in fact 4 other recent internationals in that side. They've played some pretty tough sides.
They've ended up playing a lot of the same players, but in different uniforms. The quality of opposition they've played certainly has been of a high standard. And you know, with international sides coming over here, we really want to show them our best players.
Full count on Okamoto. Hits this 1 and 2 right field. That should fall safely. In fact, it is a safe hit going for second. In comes a throw. He'll get there standing up. So a lovely stand-up double for Okamoto to get Japan underway in the top of the second inning.
Yeah, well, Okamoto certainly gets out of that funk that he's been in. As you can see here, rise ball left out over the plate. Just hit it off the end of the bat. Finds the gap in the right centre field alley. And Thomas Markey is right in behind it, but as you can see, Okamoto hustling around to second base with a stand-up double.
Well, the Black Sox will be hoping that that's enough to hit that breaks the drought for Okamoto. So Hiroshi Ishimura now comes into bat, playing in right field.
Well, he's the best performing of the Japanese hitters so far in this series. There you see it, 3 hits, 6 turns at bat for an average of 500.
Looking for the bunt to move the run around. Must be a temptation to hit him though, considering that he has been pretty successful so far in the series.
Yeah,
Coach Igawa has to really take to be a little bit objective here, in that he's got to make sure that first and foremost they've got to give themselves an opportunity to score runs, and it's a lot easier to score runs with runners on third base as opposed to second. So he's going to sacrifice the batter here to try and advance the runner to third. And if Ishimura can get that bunt down as he squares back and then tries to do a chopping slap. So he's just trying to vary it here.
Here's the head coach for Japan, Igawa.
So I think varying it's probably a good option as well, because I think the one lesson the Japanese have learned in the game so far is that one run's not going to be enough against the Black Sox. So sure, try and advance that runner down to three, but maybe if you can cause some confusion and maybe get that better base runner on as well, there's a bonus for you.
This one fouled off. You talk about one run not being enough. You know, 2 years ago at the World Series, in fact less than 2 years ago, the World Series in South Africa, that's all there was between these two teams. It was a 1-0 to New Zealand over Japan in the final, and in the round robin it was 2-1 to Japan over New Zealand. So that's why the scores that we've had in this series so far have been such a surprise.
Certainly have, and the games that we've played.
Hitting this time, and it takes off the glove of Michael Gager. Nice recovery to try and get the out at first. Lovely out by Michael Gager. The ball took his glove off, but he recovered and had Ishimura taken out.
Here we see Ishimura just driving it back to Gager. You see the glove go flying. Gager picks it up, backhand throw,
down to
Jared Martin at first base. So that's a great throw he made, great recovery across the first base, and he basically threw that backhand without even looking.
So Ishimura does his job and sacrifices himself to move the run around. Okamoto now at third, and one down. Into bat comes Kazushi Matamura.
Kazushi Matamura.
Playing in center field.
Hisao Uchi.
Strike one on Matamura.
Andrea, what I was saying before was that the games that we've had over against Japan over the years have really been tight fought affairs, and I think we've only ever had maybe one or two games that have been a blowout. So certainly having two in a row the last two games has been surprising but pleasing.
Fouled off.
Well, we've got Matuda in the batter's box now, and we saw his statistics just briefly, but he's one of 5 hitters in this Japanese side who have no average so far and who have been hitting in this series.
You can see the rain just getting a little bit heavier here at Rosedale Park.
Time.
In fact, the umpire, Lindsay Edwards, has called time, and I think the players are going to leave the diamond. Yes, it looks like we're coming off
Hopefully this is just a temporary stop because the forecast is not for the rain to come this early in the day. Quite heavy at the moment though.
Feel free to go and get something to eat and something to drink.
So we're in the top of the second inning. Japan with the runner on third. And no score in this game between New Zealand and Japan. We're going to take a break because of rain.
Here we go, ladies and gentlemen.
Well, the rain has abated here at Rosedale Park in Albany, and the game has resumed. Japan, member with a runner poised on third, that is Okamoto, got there courtesy of that lovely double.
Oh. Now, that's really poor base running there by Okamoto, because first pitch back after a rain delay, he would have seen that Michael Gager only threw one or two pitches. And he came off third base and didn't watch where the ball went. Now that's a cardinal sin, and he's cost his team a run right there.
So here is Matura, still at third. Sorry, Okamoto at third. It is Matura who's at bat, number 33. Into foul territory.
I think Michael Gager needs a bit of a tune-up there as well, because if you come out when the weather's still dicey, you've got to make sure that you're ready to throw that first pitch, especially with a run on third base there. And I know that, you know, Michael sets high standards, but in that instance, he may have thrown two pitches as a warm-up. So not really a great... a warm-up or lead-in to trying to shut down the Japanese here.
Michael Gager just shaking off his catcher there. Foul again from Matura. Difficult, isn't it, with weather like this, you know, a game that stops and starts, you know, if team loses momentum, must be hard on the players.
Yeah, it is, but I know the thing that that we try to concentrate on with the Black Sox is that worry about things that you can control, and the weather is something we obviously can't control, so don't let that inclement weather creeping in here affect our attitude and the way that we're going to approach the game.
So one ball, two strikes on Matura. Okamoto at third.
This is a worrying sign here. Michael Gage is spending a lot of time away from that ball on his glove.
This is a bit of a test for the ball as well, isn't it? Because this is the Rawlings ball that Softball New Zealand has been developing in conjunction with Rawlings. And this is the first season we've seen it used, the iridescent yellow ball. It has a different surface to the one the teams have been used to in recent years. Ooh, pitch inside from Gager, and Matura just has to jump back to get out of the way of that one.
Not a ball that's winning a lot of positive votes from pitchers on both teams here. It's a very hard ball, seams are very high, but it's the material that's made in the cover has a synthetic mix to it, which when it's brought out in this weather, makes it very, very hard to grip.
Full count. This one is high, but it's in the infield. And the catch is made in the end by Rhys Casely.
Rhys Casely takes the second out.
That is the second out of the innings. Yeah, Gager doesn't look happy, does he? He's been wiping that ball. They've changed the ball. Into bat now, Hisao Iguchi. So two down now. That runner still on third. Pitch outside for ball one to Iguchi. So Iguchi yet to have any luck with the bat on this tour, in this series. Ball two. So you see now the New Zealand catcher, Patrick Shannon, just going out to have a chat with Gager.
That's a good time for Patrick Shannon to go out and talk to Michael Gager there, just making sure that Michael's aware of the count, the outs, situation of the game, and to go over the game plan that they're...
Fouled off again by Iguchi.
Yeah, the game plan that they would have sorted out before the game for each individual hitter on the Japanese side.
Coach Igawa, he'll be wanting to capitalise on this. He knows that chances will be few and far between against this Black Sox team. Runner at third with no outs is what they had. Now there are two down.
Three balls, one strike. Runner on three.
So three balls, one strike to the count. Ball four to Iguchi, and he will pick a walk. So Japan now with two runners on base.
Iguchi goes to first base.
And brings up to bat the catcher, Masashi Ito.
In comes Masashi Ito, and on deck.
So the Black Sox infield is having a little bit of a conference before this next batter comes in. Runs on the corners now. Good opportunity for Japan. There are two down, but I think with the break that we've had, a little bit of loss of momentum by the pitcher, Japan are going to want to cash in on this. So Masashi Ito has been the starting catcher in all three games of the series so far. Heard quite a bit of noise from him behind the plate. Lively character. Ball one to Ito.
He's been trying to upset the New Zealand hitters when they were coming into the batter's box with the vocal support that he was giving his pitchers, but to date it hasn't really affected them in the series.
Strike one. One ball, one strike.
Ball one. Strike one.
Gager just needs to recover his composure. Pitch outside, ball two, strike one. You can hear the support coming from the Japanese dugout, because this is probably one of the best opportunities they've had in the series. Haven't had a couple of runners on base too often. Even with two down, it's a good chance for them here. Ball three to Ito.
We have ball three here. Strike one. Two down, runners on the corners.
Well, the pressure now really on Gager. He's runners on the corners on one and three. Two down, but he has three balls already on this batter. And he needs to come back now, or he'll give up another walk and load the bases. Smacked this one down to second base. Across it goes, and the innings are taken. Nice smooth play there by Rhys Casely, and Ito unable to pick up any RBIs, but Japan with a couple of runners on.
Michael Gager fighting back after battling with that wet ball in the innings, and gets a ground ball to Rhys Casely to end the threat posed by Japan there in the second innings.
Yes, I just think Japan let New Zealand off the hook there. I felt that with the rain delay, with Gager just struggling with his control a little bit on the mound, there was an opportunity there for them to score a couple of runs.
Yeah, also, you know, that pass ball, wild pitch, they lost a run, scoring opportunity there. It's always important when on bases to make sure that your head's up on every single pitch. You never know what can happen.
This Japanese team, in the games that we've seen them play, Mark, I just have felt that they haven't looked quite as switched on as we might expect for, you know, to see from a Japanese side, second in the world.
Yeah, I've sort of, there's a lot of guys out there I don't know, and I've been playing against the Japanese side for 15, 16 years now, and even though you don't always know their name, you kind of know faces, and I just wonder if they've really got the strongest team possible to come out here. You know, I think that possibly there's been some unavailabilities or injuries, because I know the quality of pitching that Japan has had at the last World Champs, and that was something that all teams came out talking about, was
the fact that, geez, these little Japanese fellas threw the ball as hard as any and were as good as every pitcher there and better. Nishimura was widely regarded as being the best pitcher at the World Champs. So, yeah, I've been a little bit disappointed, I guess, to say, in the first couple of games of the series with a lack of competitiveness from the Japanese side.
I suppose if you consider, you know, the Black Sox will go on a North American tour later this year, and if you consider the team that they might select for that compared to the team they've selected for this series, there will be differences. I mean, they will take two or three guys on that North American tour who might not make a World Series side if it was selected tomorrow, but are players they think might be in the frame in 2 years' time when the World Series is played. So I guess that maybe that's the attitude Japan have taken. Maybe there are a few players in here that they're testing. There are players that they know about already, that from home didn't need to bring them here. They know everything about them. But guys here that they may be you know, outside, just on the edges of national selection, looking towards that 2004 World Series.
Yeah, you learn a lot about players when you take them on a tour. With the rigors and the stresses that are involved in touring, you do learn a great deal more. So I guess you're right that possibly, you know, plus work commitments, you know, maybe some of the guys do have work commitments that are preventing them from coming out.
Well, leading off for New Zealand in the bottom of the second innings then is Patrick Shannon. It's a very open stance of his. And very successful with it too. Hit a home run in game two of the series. Done a good job catching as well. This will be the third pitcher that he's caught to in the series today. Augie continues with this very deliberate pitching style. Shannon goes for the low ball and hits it back into his foot. Dead ball is called by umpire Lindsay Edwards.
Dead ball.
Get a look at that arm guard that Patrick has on his left arm, protecting that elbow. With the open nature of his stance and the fact that he has to step in, that we see it in closer to the plate, what he's found over the years is that a lot of pitchers tend to throw him inside, and he was getting hit on the arm quite regularly. So it's quite a regular thing in baseball in the States where guys are wearing those arm guards.
What an elaborate piece of protection there, isn't it?
Looks like the Terminator, isn't it?
Yeah. Outside for a ball to Patrick Shannon.
I think also with his type of hitting style, if you like, given that he's continually closing in with his body on the plate, that sometimes he may not be able to correct himself all that easily and get out of the way of a pitch that's coming towards the inside of the plate, and that might be another reason for needing that protection.
Shannon reaches for this one and fouls it off, so working the outside of the plate here again with Patrick Shannon. His first at bat in this game. New Zealand with one runner on in the bottom of the first, and Shannon now leading off.
It's interesting, we just heard a call there from Lindsay Edwards to the batter. He just said, "Paddy, you're just calling back in the box a bit," meaning that the umpire was just warning Patrick Shannon that he may be a little bit deep with his starting position. Think back to game one against Japan and Nelson, where he actually clipped the glove of the catcher and was awarded a catcher's interference.
I think what he's actually trying to do is get out of the puddle that's developed in the batter's box as well.
Full count now on Patrick Shannon. Three balls, two strikes.
Three balls, two strikes.
See Lindsay Edwards there just doing a little bit of the housework around the plate, I think. The rain.
Just kind of talking to him about it again, wasn't he? You know, there is benefit for the hitters the further back in the box you can get. That gives you a little bit longer look. And there we see the sitting water that Patrick is straddling, basically.
He's stepping into it, isn't he?
Mm.
Ball four for Patrick Shannon. He will walk good lead off for New Zealand at the bottom of the second.
None down.
Second walk of the game for
runner on the corner.
Augie.
And in comes
brings to bat Brad Rona.
And on deck, Fabian Marchia.
As Shannon just discards the arm protection, hands it off to the assistant coach Eddie Colassi down there at first base. Brad Rona, third baseman, playing at his home ground, member of the Northcote Club, represents North Harbour at provincial level. And here's the bunt from Rona. Runner going to second. They go for the out at first, so a good job done by Brad Rona. The sacrifice bunt moves Patrick Shannon down to second. One down.
Yeah, great bunt to win ball games. See Brad Rona executing very, very well. Only played for Okamoto, was over to first base. But the key to that was that we advanced Patrick Shannon down to second, and now he's in scoring position with Fabian Marchia, who's been enjoying a hot period with the bat in the first two games of the series.
Right, really is starting to step out of the shadow of his older and probably more famous brother, Thomas Marchia. He's been one of the outstanding players for New Zealand so far in this series. And probably someone who may get just a few more opportunities with that injury to Stacey McLean. There has been another player brought into the squad to replace McLean. Kurt Allen from the Auckland Maris Club has joined the team on their arrival in the Auckland North Harbour area.
Notice how long these Japanese pitcher and catcher take in between pitches. You mentioned before about them being very precise, but Odie can only throw the pitch once he's received the signal from catcher Ito, and Ito seems to take an eternity to give that signal to him.
Well, it is. It's a good sort of 3 or 4 seconds bent over like that every time, isn't it? Ball in the dirt, and Shannon thinks about going, but no, back to second. So one down, runner on second, and Fabian Marchia batting at number 8 for this New Zealand team, but that just shows you how deep they bat. This guy has 2 home runs so far in the series. The count is 2 balls. Outside of the plate again. Ball 3. A little respect to be shown to Fabian Marchia here.
To the runner on 2. One down.
Here we go. Sorry, Andrea. We're still at. We just see Ito now putting the signal down. There's quite a delay there. Maybe he doesn't really know what he wants to actually throw.
Do you think that's what it is? It's indecision, as we see a walk for Fabian Marchia. So 2 runners on base now.
Or is it,
not let New Zealand get into a rhythm? I mean, is it a deliberate delaying tactic?
Yeah, could well be a ploy of theirs. But with the indecisive nature, it seems that Ito is performing behind the mound. I don't actually think he's planning 2 or 3 pitches ahead, which a catcher is supposed to do. They're supposed to use this pitch to set up the next pitch, which will set up the third pitch down the track. So you always got to be thinking ahead, and I think Ito's just calling off the seat of his pants at the moment and not having any really plan or structure to it.
So Roman Gabriel now, the number 9 batter on this New Zealand lineup. One down and 2 runners on. You'd have to back the Black Sox to score a couple of runs here. It's going to be a good test for Japan. Well, Ito, he's only 22 years of age, and this is his debut tour with the Japanese team. So I guess in terms of catching, that's pretty young.
Extremely young, yeah, and catching's a position that you really develop over the years.
Fouled off by Gabriel.
Roman Gabriel.
I was going to say earlier that despite this persistent rain, which is falling, the crowd have stayed here at Rosedale Park, which is good to see. I get too many opportunities to see the world champions of softball against the team rated 2nd in the world.
Just such a shame we've got this weather here. Probably something that the Aucklanders are quite used to, though, I suppose.
K
can't say too much, Mark. It rained for the first three innings of game two in Lower Hutt.
Turned out a beautiful night, though.
Well, let's hope we get the same result weather-wise here. One ball, one strike, the count on Roman Gabriel. Strike called by the umpire, Lindsay Edwards.
Well, we mentioned it in game one, and we'll say it again in this game. The Japanese really aren't exploiting the width of the plate as much as I'd like to see. New Zealand umpires have been calling one or one and a half balls off the plate consistently throughout this series. They had a little bit of success with that in Nelson. They just haven't been doing it here at all.
Check swing by Gabriel.
No, you're right. Maybe it's that they haven't identified that, but possibly they haven't run up against it before, because really if the ball has to go over the plate for it to be a strike, and balls, like you talk about, they're calling one and a half balls off the plate, so that means that the ball isn't actually crossing the plate. So maybe they haven't run up against that before. You know, they know to go to the corners and try and stretch it, but not quite as far as what we've been used to seeing.
So we could see some action here. This is a full count on Roman Gabriel. Runners on one and two. Patrick Shannon and Fabian Marquia. Oh, and Roman Gabriel strikes out. He'll be disappointed with that. Second out of the innings.
In comes Clayton Willis. And on deck, Reed Casey.
Yeah, Roman just not really ready to hit here, as you can see. Really looking for the walk. His back foot dropped back as though he was going to first base and wasn't actually up there looking to drive the ball. Got to be aggressive in that situation. Runners on base, full count, pitcher has to come to you.
So Augie wins the battle on this occasion. New Zealand go back to the top of the order now. Clayton Willicks had a ground ball taken out at first in his first turn at bat. But now with two runners on, two down. Strike one on Clayton Willicks.
Saw the speed of Clayton Willicks early in the series, leading off the game in the first match of the series, stealing base.